Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Golden Speakers Toastmaster meeting. We meet every Tuesday evening at 7:45 in the Hy-Vee Club Room. I would like to introduce our president, Jean Symington Craig.
Greetings, everyone, and viewers at home. I'm not seeing any guests, but I am seeing a new member. We'll get to you in just a moment. We met you last week, but again, as our Sergeant at Arms mentioned, you are at Golden Speakers Toastmasters. We are at the end of the ice cream aisle every Tuesday evening, 7:45 to 9:15. You're always welcome to come. Bring your shopping list. It's such a handy thing to do. Kill two birds with one stone, unless you're vegetarian. Then you collect two broccoli. Oh, well, forget that. I can't carry that farther along. But anyway, this is where we are, and the mission of the Toastmasters Club is to provide a mutually supportive and positive learning environment in which every member has the opportunity to develop oral communication and leadership skills, which in turn foster self-confidence and personal growth. Does anyone have I'll pick someone from the audience, someone who has a short story, quick little comment on something that they did this last week that where they felt that extra self-confidence and or personal growth? Raven?
Yes, I was at a meeting of a different kind, and they needed somebody to come up to the front of the room just to read, and I raised my hand hoping that they would pick someone else, but they picked me, and I just felt very comfortable, and I could tell that my speech was clearer and louder, and I felt really helped by Toastmasters.
Okay, that's a good result. Thank you. Well, that's what we build in Toastmasters, is that ability to get up and feel comfortable and even have fun when we're in front of the room. I know we're going to have an icebreaker today, is that right? So, congratulations, you're going to have the fun of getting up here, and we will help you off if we need to get you back to your seat. No worry, you'll be fine. And Maya, maybe you could just stand and tell us what encouraged you to become a member after just visiting last week for the first time.
Yeah, well, actually I'm calling F2 visa, and I'm just feel boring since I have nothing to do. So,
nothing else to do.
Yes.
Might as well, do some personal growth. What do you say? Yes.
Yes, because maybe 2 weeks ago, I had some problems about understand people's ideas, but after maybe a week, I feel that I am a little progress on my listening and speaking.
Good. It feels good, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. So we're also Toastmasters. On top of conquering fear, it's also about feeling good, feeling better and better. So congratulations, guys. Tonight we have a very full schedule. We are going to be, Einar is here. Einar's been a guest before. Einar slipped in just before the hatchet went down. Einar, just a guest, would you like to say what brought you back here again tonight?
I just couldn't resist.
Well, that is the best answer ever. And he had nothing better to do? Is that what I heard? This is going to be the joke. Whatever brought you here, it's a good thing. So let's go ahead and, what I was going to say was that we are going to be doing our officer elections tonight at the end. We do have a basic slate. However, we can take additional nominations from the floor, as those of you possibly who've decided at the last minute maybe this is something that you want to do, we can work with that. But we do have a good slate so far, and we'll see if we can put that into place. And then next week, the first Tuesday in June, we have our regular officer meeting, and we will ask the new officers to also attend that meeting. So we'll have both current officers and upcoming officers in the same place, and I will be handing out special leadership manuals to those officers who will be continuing for the upcoming year. So we've got a lot to do. With that, I feel like that was one of those like opera singers that sang the high note and the glass shatters. I said, with that, yes, right.
Jean, just for the new officers to keep in mind, July 9th is a Division B officer training. So that's a date we should keep in mind, because as we'll explain next week at the officers' meeting, we'd like all officers are required to attend two training sessions a year, once in the summer and once around January or so. So
okay.
Just keep that in mind, July.
That's coming quick.
Yes.
Okay, great. Well, we get it done and we're over and we get started. Okay, well, I was going to say, before the room started falling off, that I would like to warmly welcome up our Toastmaster for the evening, Tabitha Sedgwick.
Good evening, Toastmasters, guests, and viewers at home. Thank you all for being here, and what I'm going to do now is introduce you to our role players for the evening. Our first role player is Mahesh, and I will let him tell you all about being the timer.
Good evening, everyone. My role is the timer today. So today I'm going to be keeping track of all the times that the prepared speeches and the table topics and the evaluators and the general evaluators. I'll be turning green light at 4 minutes, and then yellow light at 5 minutes and red light at 6 minutes. The speaker will be allowed to give like extra 30 minutes, 30 seconds, and then after a minute I'll be clapping. Thank you.
Are there more roles? Do you do all the roles?
At the end of the speech, I'll be telling all the speakers what time they will speak.
Say all the roles. Evaluator and table
We were just wondering if Mahesh had listed all the different roles and the times that each of those roles get. So we're just checking in because we don't know. Did you?
Yes.
Okay.
I did give you.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, and we can hear about that as we go along, so we're all very clear. Okay, and now our grammarian for the evening is our president, Jean Symington Craig.
I like that move. Our word for the night is obfuscate. And Rick told me this is one of his favorite words, so just so you know. And it means to render something obscure, make it unclear, make it unintelligible. Have you ever been in a class where the professor seemed to be deliberately doing that, making things worse rather than clarifying? Well, that's what that is. It's a verb, and it also means to bewilder someone. So my sentence is, he offered mere rationalizations, almost like excuses, that serve to obfuscate rather than clarify the real issue. So obfuscate is on one end of the scale and clarify is kind of on the other side. I will be looking also for creative uses of the English language, possible areas where that could be improved, and I'll be giving a report at the end of the meeting. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And one of our newer members, Feng, will be introducing what an awe counter does.
Good evening, everyone. Amanda, I'm your awe counter. And at the awe counter, I will note words and sounds used as a class or post filter by anyone who speaks during tonight. And words may be inappropriate interjections such as I, well, but, so you know. Sounds like and I wish I will have zero counter tonight. Good luck, Eric.
Thank you, Fung. And our general evaluator for the evening is Emery. And you don't need to say anything about that now, I guess.
That's right.
I'm just saying that that's who's doing that tonight. And I
Thank
suppose.
Thank you for de-obfuscating.
And also, our greeter joke master is Dan Craig, and we'll get to hear from him later. Our first speech tonight is the icebreaker, which is the first speech in our Confident Communicator Manual. And that will be delivered by, I can do this, Hwajing. Okay, great. And then Will Burns will introduce Hwajing and his speech for you shortly, because he's going to be evaluating this speech tonight.
Thank you, Tabitha. We are in the midst of a groundbreaking event. We are about to witness a new speaker come out here and give his icebreaker. He will banish the demons of fear, self-loathing, cowardice, and embrace confidence, articulate speech, and clarity. His objective is to begin speaking before an audience and to discover speaking skills that are buried deep inside of him, but that he may not have realized he had. It will be between 4 to 6 minutes. Wai Jin is a student at MUM, at MUM, giving CC number one, the icebreaker. The title of his speech, The Road to America. Please warmly welcome Wai Jin.
Good evening, Toastmasters, and Toastmasters and guests. Yes. Tonight, I want to talk about my story, my road to America. In October 2013, one of my friends returned back to China from USA for her vacation. We had made a meal together, and she suggested that there was a very good chance for me to move to USA. She got some information about MUM from one of her friends in their church. MUM provides a computer science master project for international students with very low admission requirements. There is no GRE required if a candidate has good enough GPA, and no TOEFL required if a candidate has basic English communication skills. And moreover, for the tuition part, MUM also provides financial AID So students only can pay around $7,000 as initial payment. I decided to take this opportunity 1 year later. I submitted my application in October 2014. But MUM declined my case. They gave me the following reasons. Your GPA is a bit lower than our minimum requirement, 2.7. And then your background of recent 5 years is closer to management positions, not to the technical positions. And they also requested me to take GRE test. And GRE test is really hard, especially for the international students. Mahesh, did you take GRE test?
No, I didn't take the GRE test, but it was so hard. I didn't have any college to take.
Okay. How about you, Fong?
No, because my GPA meter there.
Okay. Very good. So, I decided to take GRE test one day later. In the next 4.5 months, I studied very, really, really hard. Every night, I was studying from 11 p.m. to 6 a.m. or 7 a.m. and then went to bed. At that time, I had a flexible working hours, so I can go to the office around lunchtime. Even in the Chinese New Year holiday seasons of 2015, I still studied every day, every night. And I took GRE test on March 9th of 2015. And I got 164 points out of 170.
Wow.
All quantitative reasoning section of GRE test. But for another part is not so good. it's much better than the minimum requirement of MUM. So finally, they accepted my application. And I arrived in Fairfield on October 21st of last year. The reason why I tried so hard to come to US is I had been working in Beijing for 16 years. I don't want to repeat myself again and again. The same as a proverb, Roland. He said, most men die at 20 or 30. After that, they are only reflections of themselves. For the rest of their lives, they are aping themselves. So for me, life is an experience. I just want to experience more. And on the other hand, I also want to provide a better education environment to my son. And by the way, I also got the troubles during my visa application process. Next time, I will introduce that part. Thank you.
I'm gonna not step away from the podium, but if our guests would like to evaluate, there's plenty of extra, if anybody wants to hand him an extra evaluation sheet, that'd be great. Okay, welcome back. Everyone, we can fill in a little bit later. Right now, it's time to introduce our next evaluator, who will be introducing Pia. She's gonna be doing her speech tonight on Get to the Point. Please welcome Raven Garland.
Hi,
Educator's Manual tonight from Pia. Pia has recently graduated from MUM. She majored in sustainable living. This year, she is volunteering at AmeriCorps as the education coordinator. Pia enjoys many quiet activities such as drawing and reading, and she avoids being in the limelight as one would avoid the plague. She's making a great exception, though, by joining Toastmasters. Her speech tonight is titled, Am I Going to Live My Fears or My Dreams? The objectives of this speech: select a speech topic and determine its general and specific purposes. Organize the speech in a manner that best achieves those purposes. Ensure the beginning, body, and conclusion reinforce the purposes. Project sincerity and conviction, and control any nervousness you may feel. Strive not to use notes. This is a 5 to 7 minute speech. Please help me welcome Pia. Today, I'd like to talk to you about fear. And to begin, I'll share a quote by Les Brown, who's a former politician and motivational speaker. Too many of us fail to live our dreams because we are living our fears. I have to admit that lately I've been caught up in living my fears instead of living my dreams. What I aim to do in this speech is to share my dreams and fears with you and present a question that you can ask yourself when you feel your fears coming up in the same way and preventing yourself from going towards your dreams. I understand that my dreams, while daunting to me and challenging, are not grand in the scheme of the world. It's more that I hope to share the idea with you that you can take and use in your own lives. And that idea and question is, am I going to live my dreams or my fears? So what are my dreams? Some of you may remember a few of these from my icebreaker. I have 3 main dreams right now. Number 1, I am going to run a marathon. Number 2, I am going to tackle my fear of public speaking. Number 3, I'm going to move abroad for at least 1 year, and that will happen, hopefully, in a few months. These dreams evolved fairly naturally from some things in my lives, and they happen to be bigger steps than I've ever taken, which is part of what makes them dreams. In terms of the marathon I aim to run, this is quite literal. It's literally distances that are further than I've ever run before. And 2 weeks ago, I ran just over a half marathon. So it was 14 miles, half marathon is 13. And I feel like this represents a significant point in my journey towards my dreams. It's about halfway through from where I started to where I want to go. And this applies also to my tackling my public speaking fears with Toastmasters. I'm about halfway through my initial commitment. I'm also on my way to moving abroad. A moment within the half marathon that I ran typifies this moment in my life for me. I had gotten 7 miles in, and I was on the loop trail just behind the hospital, and it was this gorgeous sunny day, and there were these beautiful white puffy clouds, and I had stopped to take a breather. And I looked back at the trail behind me, and I wondered, can I really do 7 miles again? Can I really do that? And I hadn't come across this quote before, the quote, will I live my dreams or my fears, but I had that thought, can I do this? Can I
go towards my dreams of going the marathon, or should I just walk back? That wasn't a very appealing option because it's 7 miles and that would be a long time. But I had kind of gotten myself into that position. There was very little other options that I could do. So I just ran. And this moment of decision is also where I am with your public speaking. I don't think I've adequately impressed to everyone how much I hate public speaking. I would literally rather be anywhere else at this moment than where I am right now. That's just how I feel about public speaking. It's nothing personal. At least with marathon running, I've used those muscles before. With public speaking, I feel like I've avoided using these muscles entirely, and now it's like I'm trying to lift a weight, and I know I'm growing, but it's very painful, and I'm not sure if I want to lift that weight one more time. Like, I have that thought. My travel plans are probably the area where I have gone the least distance so far. This is really uncharted territory for me. I've traveled a bit before, but never long enough to need a visa. And I know it's possible to get visas, it's just new to me, and I'm not really sure what that process is like. I know it's possible because I have friends from other countries and they have visas, so clearly it does happen. But this is a new challenge to me. I also have only really applied to the current position that I'm in right now, and so applying for a position in another country is stepping a couple steps, in my opinion, skipping a couple steps. It's like I need to shoot a tie-breaking game in a professional basketball game, and I've never played basketball before. That's what it feels like. So, and I've enlisted some help from mentors to help me with this process, but no one can make this shot for me, nor do I want them to. But it's a lot of pressure. Out of my three big dreams that I have right now, this is the one that I have my heart set on the most, and I'm most afraid of missing this particular shot, because it's the next year of my life on the line. It's what I want to do. Which brings me back to the quote of living our fears or either living our dreams, because I've broadcasted my dreams at this point, and I'm on my way to achieving them, but I have some doubts about my ability to go the last distance. And I have a choice right now. Am I going to live my fears or my dreams? In this moment, I'm making the conscious choice to live my dreams. I say that to myself and I'm saying it to you. This is my commitment. My hope for you is that when you find yourself doubting, that you can make your dreams a reality, that you remember this question and think, I will keep going because I would rather live my dreams than my fears. Thank you.
Thank you, Pia, and for being such an example of courage for us tonight, being up here, even though it's the last place on earth you want to be right now. Okay, so our next speaker is going to be Nope, we have to evaluate Pia. So the timer will now put 2 minutes on the clock. Let us know when that 2 minutes is up while you get to evaluate Pia. Okay, welcome back everyone. Now it's time to give our attention to our next speaker will be Rick, and introducing Rick will be Andal Krishna, his evaluator.
Good evening, Toastmasters, guests, and viewers at home. Today, Rick is going to give his topic, he's going to give his speech on competent communication, and his topic is project number 9, Persuade with Power. Rick has been a member of Toastmasters and Golden Speaker since 2013. And he's also been a member of the Cambridge Tech Master Corporate Club. Rick is doing project number 9, and his topic is You Can Do It. Let's welcome Rick. You can do it.
My first Toastmasters meeting. I'm scared to death. I don't know how I got talked into this. Wait a second, now she's talking about getting up there and giving a speech, not even knowing what it's about. She's looking right at me. She wants me to get up there. I can't do it. Madam Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, honored guests, thank you for coming, and viewers at home. You can do it. You can become a good public speaker. You can overcome your fears, and you can be comfortable speaking in front of large groups. Today, I'm going to give you Rick's 3 rules. The 3 rules you'll need to follow to be a successful public speaker. The first rule, you're afraid to death. You're shaking. What you do is you stand up, you walk to the front of the room, and you give your speech. What's the worst thing that could happen? I guess the worst thing that could happen is you get up there and die. I don't think anybody's ever died giving a Toastmaster speech, and I don't think that'll happen to you. What else could go wrong? You could get up here and everybody starts laughing at you, starts making fun of you. This is Toastmasters. As Jean says every week, our motto is to provide a safe, supportive environment. We like you. We want to support you. We're on your side. The only comments you'll get are kind comments about what you did right, and maybe some constructive criticisms about how you could get better, but all delivered in a spirit of kindness. The next of Rick's rules, speak about what you're passionate about. Speak what you're interested in. If you go through the Competent Communicator Manual, each project is another in a series of skills you need for public speaking. But it doesn't say anything about the content of the speech. So you can put anything you want in there. And if you are speaking confidently, if you're speaking about something that you enjoy, your enthusiasm will show through. Think of something that if you were going to sit down with your friend and just talk for a half hour about and use that for a speech, somehow fit it in to the structure of that speech. There's a corollary to this rule, we'll call this rule 2.1. And that is, never let facts interfere with a good story. You're not a politician. Nobody's going to fact check your speech. So if you put things a little out of order or if you change things a little bit, that's fine. It'll make for a better story and it'll be more entertaining. And the third of Rick's rules is enter a contest. And you think, enter a contest? I can barely get up in front of 20 people and speak. How can I enter a contest? I was at the International Speech Contest, the district contest last weekend, and there were 5 final contestants, 1 from each division in the state. And of those 5, a couple were in Toastmasters for 7 or 8 years. but all three of the rest were only in Toastmasters for 1 or 2 years. A case in point is our own Raven Garland. Raven was in Toastmasters for about a year or so when she started. She won the club competition for speaking. She won the area competition. She won the division competition. And she went on to the state competition. I was pretty sick and tired of hearing that speech she ordered, because I had heard it every single time. But every time Raven said it, it got better. And the year before this, another member of a local club, Becky Dubay from the Cambridge Club, also went on to state, and she had only been a Toastmaster for about a year. So follow these three rules. Remember Rick's three rules. Just get up and speak, even if you're scared. Speak about something you're enthusiastic about, and even though you can't imagine doing it, enter a contest. Thank you.
So we can go ahead and find out from our timer who of the three speeches qualified this evening.
All of the speakers qualified this evening.
Okay, great. All of the speakers qualified, and now you get a chance to vote for who you thought was the best speaker out of Rick, Pia, and Wajing. Welcome back. Now I'm going to introduce our general evaluator for the evening, Emery Styron.
Thank you, Jonathan. Good evening, fellow members, guests, new member, and viewers at home. I just missed last week, and I feel like I haven't been here in 6 months or something.
Yeah.
I don't know why. Well, I am the general evaluator, and it's my job to evaluate the evaluators and comment on any other parts of the meeting. And I hope to clarify with my remarks rather than obfuscate or confuse. I would now like to introduce our first evaluator, Will Burns, who will be evaluating Wajing.
If you'd stand for a minute, and let's have another hand here for his first icebreaker. Thank you very much. And this also gives us the opportunity, you may sit down now, sir, to appreciate the fine tailored suit he was wearing. I, as many people, as many audiences and audience members, I have a real appreciation for some of you who sits up here who speaks both eloquently and is also dressed professionally. It showed that he was well on his way to being a professional speaker. Wai Jin, your story had drama. You were faced with this triple threat of low GPA, not enough technical experience, and the GRE test. And you embarked on a hero's journey without ever leaving your home. You forsaked friends, fancy dining, and the Chinese New Year festival to craft the books and and study to be able to defeat that and pass the test with accolades. If I had one suggestion for you, it would be to simplify some elements of your speech. For example, the part you talked about men dying at 20 or 30. They are merely aping themselves up. Not enough for that. I think that was a great message, but I felt like it could be simplified down a little bit. Okay. Simplified. But I loved your confidence in staying up here and asking the guests in the audience, not one guest, but two guests, about their experience. That's always a risky thing to do because you never know quite what somebody's going to say. But you were very confident and you were very apt, very able to handle the response. I think it's a great mark of a good speaker. Finally, you closed with us with a hook of potential visa trouble, and I personally really want to hear more. Thank you.
Evaluator is Raven Garland. We will evaluate Pia.
Thank you, Raven.
What a treat to see somebody get up and right before our very eyes overcome her fear. So this talk was get to the point. I'm just going to go through the manual and tell you the first category for the evaluator to look at was the general purpose of the speech clear? And I would say it was totally clear that this speech was meant to inspire us and that Pia was quite successful. She was successful because she had such a good story herself and a very believable, very sincere. And she brought back her key point three or four times. It was first in her title, am I going to live my fears or am I going to live my dreams? And then she asked herself that question in her stories, and then she turned it to us. What are we going to do, live our fears or our dreams? So the specific part of her speech was also very clear. It was really about overcoming fears, and in particular, three dreams that Pia herself has. The speech organization supported the speech's specific purpose. Yes, I felt like it did. The main points and supporting material contributed to the speech's specific purpose. I felt every story that Pia told supported what she was trying to do. She was trying to describe where she was in her process of overcoming her fears and living, really going for her dreams, and also inspiring us. The beginning, body, and conclusion reinforced the specific purpose. Yes, the speaker achieved the specific purpose. Would you all say you're inspired to actually ask yourself that question? Am I going to live my dreams or my fears? Mm-hmm. Yes, I know I've heard the quote four times and I feel like I will actually think of it. The speaker appeared confident and sincere with minimal nervousness. So definitely sincere and definitely nervous. I think, though, with this topic, it actually worked in your favor to show us how nervous you were. The one thing that you could have done better was to come out from behind the podium and show us, like, I am frightened. Because one thing is you described to us how you would rather be anywhere than up here giving a public speech. And yet there you were. So you have overcome it. That would have taken a lot of willingness to really show your vulnerability. It showed anyway, but that was my only suggestion, it would have made it a little better. It was very clear, there was nothing that was obfuscated in the whole speech. I loved your analogy of the basketball game when you've never played basketball before. So all in all, you stayed up here and you did another step towards your dream of overcoming your fear of public speaking. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. our final speech evaluator tonight is Andal, who will evaluate Rick.
Sincerity and the conviction. Of course he did. I would say it was excellent because the way he started the story by saying how scared a person was, and then he started the story of saying, okay, there are 3 points, with 3 points, how to get out of the fear. Was the speaker a credible source of information about the topic? Mm-hmm. Yes. I just gave a satisfactory here because I felt like I was wanting to hear more from you, but then by then it got you finished the topic. So I felt like I was still eager to know more about your topic. So did the speaker phrase his or her appeal in terms of the audience self-interest? Of course, it was very much the interest of the audience and the purpose for why we are gathering here. So it did. So that was excellent. Did the speech opening capture the audience interest? Yes, of course, it did. It was an excellent opening. Did the speaker use facts and logic reasoning to support his or his views? Yes, it did have a logic and reasoning where he gave 3 points how to get out of this fear to speak, and then how to speak about passion. I'm trying to figure out what I wrote. And then enter a contest to get rid of the fear. So I think he did accomplish that. Did the speaker properly use emotion to persuade the audience to support his views? Yes, he did. He rephrased about the three roles in his speech. And again, I was still wanting to hear more about emphasizing more about the points that you spoke. So it was kind of a little disappointing for me because I wanted to hear more. Was the speech organization effective? Yes, it was more effective. Did the speaker's body language and vocal variety contribute to the message? Yes, of course. He had a great voice tone, and I also noticed him moving to different parts of the stage where he was emphasizing point one and point two and point three, and then he came back to the front of the stage to emphasize his points. So it was great. Did the speaker, okay, that's great. Where you persuaded to accept the speaker's view? Absolutely, I did, and I'm sure many of the views here were persuaded, and it was excellent. What could the speaker have done differently to make the speech more effective? I would say, since I was looking more to hear, maybe the speech could have had more stories. What did you like about the speech? I liked the sincerity and conviction, and the convinced me as an audience that I should prepare myself and motivate myself to give a better speech. Thank you.
Thank you, Anna. Okay, it is now time for the table topics portion of our meeting. We'll practice a little impromptu speaking. And our guest will be welcome to participate. Tell us more about that. And run this section is Ryan Trotter-Miller.
Thank you. Greetings, Toastmasters and guests and viewers at home. The table topics section of the meeting is where we, after the prepared speeches, get a chance to practice off-the-cuff speaking based on a topic that you receive. Sometimes in a meeting or whatever, you're put on the spot, so you have to know what to say in a short amount of time, and you just say it. So the theme of the meeting tonight is the Indy 500, I believe. I don't think that was mentioned. So race car driving. In America, we have the Daytona 500, the Indy 500, and that is a large racing NASCAR experience for Americans. I don't know if there's anything like it in China, maybe not, but the Daytona 500 is...
Might have to talk louder.
Okay,
so
the Daytona 500 is a... Yeah, it's that right. Anyways, it's...
You only have 7 minutes.
I won't obfuscate anymore about the Daytona 500. So the theme of the meeting is race car driving. Those were the questions that I will be asking. So who's ready to try a question here that I have for you? Yes? Okay.
It's a member.
So about the race car experience in Indy 500. Let's say pick a number between 1 and 5.
4.
Okay, you are now a professional race car driver. Describe how you prepare for the race, what you do during the race, and what you do after the race. This is like a hypothetical. That's it.
It's a competition.
This is a competition where you're racing other people in a sports car in an arena. So how do you prepare for the race, what do you do during the race, and what do you do after? Just a hypothetical. You have 30 seconds. Yes. Think about it. Okay. And you can segue. I didn't mention you can segue. Everybody.
Okay. Today the competition of F1 Fairfield season will start. I'm the one officer for the Honda team. And I like racing because I like drive car and because I feel freedom when I drive on the highway. But today my purpose is for the competition and win the first place for the Honda team, and so I feel very nervous, and all my team members, the technician, they are all ready, and they said fighting, and I'm ready. I'm on the racing rep. Oh, after I tried my best, but I cannot beat the Ferrari behind me because the Ferrari is so nice and the performance is so good. And finally, after 50 rounds, I got my second prize, and it's a little pity, but I'm still have the yellow jacket. Yeah, and I think I will do better in the next season.
All right.
Right along. Question number two. Anybody feeling? All right, Emery. Welcome, Emery. Two. Okay. Pick number between 1 and 5, please.
1.
Okay. If a surprise opportunity came, let's see. If a surprise opportunity came your way, for example, becoming a professional race car driver for $100,000 a year. would you leave it behind for what your current life is, or would you take the opportunity?
Good evening, fellow Toastmasters and race fans. Even though $100,000 is considerably above my semi-retirement earnings as a starving freelance writer, I believe I would pass on that opportunity. Because to me, auto racing is a colossal bore. To watch cars go round and round and round and round, I cannot fathom what the appeal is. And I'm not one who cares much for noise. I enjoy quiet contemplation, and the roar is terrible. The fumes are another thing I don't care about. And then there's the factor that really the only excitement in a race is disaster. We're all really there to see somebody crack up, and which is not really funny, and is often fatal. I could go on and talk about the political atmosphere at these NASCAR events, which are mostly in the South, but I'm going to just skip that. So I'm going to pass on this wonderful earnings opportunity, but thank you for the offer.
Anybody else? $100,000 a year? Okay.
Yeah, we're just kidding. No, no, no. Wait, stay there. All right, thank you. Yeah, anybody qualified? Did everybody qualify? Oh yeah, everyone qualified. Everybody qualified. Could we get their names on the table topics? Same qualified. Fame was 1 minute and 54 seconds. Amory qualified. Amory was 1 minute and 43 seconds. All right, we vote for the best table topics value. I mean, yeah, okay.
Everyone's voted. Let's move on to the next section of the meeting, and the next section of the meeting is the evaluation of the table topic speakers. And I would like to welcome Dan Craig to run that part. Yeah.
Well, Toastmasters, guests, viewers at home, we had two quick hits on table topics tonight. They were both quite fun. Our first speaker was fun. And I particularly liked, after he thought a bit, that he came out with the idea of freedom, that driving is freedom. I thought that was a really good start, that he could find the thing that he would love most about it. The other thing that I liked about your talk, Fung, was that you got into character. You began to think as a race car driver and how you had a responsibility to your team, and then you thought that through and told us that even though you did your best, you didn't quite win, but at least you had a yellow jersey. I'm not sure about that, how that rule works, but excellent, all in all. I don't really have a suggestion for you other than speak more, speak often. We enjoyed hearing you and want to hear more. Our next speaker was Emery, and he painted a really black picture for us of all the problems with NASCAR racing. I think our viewers at home, they're probably up in arms at this point. I pretty much agree with you point by point on NASCAR racing. But I would dispute the fact that it's boring for everyone. It's not boring for the drivers. If you've ever seen an in-cab camera of a race car driver going around the track at 200 miles an hour, that's not boring. But I wouldn't do it for 100,000, maybe for 1 million. I think you lost a zero. My only suggestion for Emory is just to use the stage a little bit. I believe you talked to us from here. If you had moved about, I think you would have connected with us a bit more and improved the talk even more. But really good humor, lots of good points, and I think that probably none of us other than Fung want to be a driver.
Thank you. Which evaluators qualified?
All the evaluators qualified except Amanda. Her time was 3 minutes and 45 seconds.
Well, we don't need your time. If they have qualified.
Will qualified, Ryan qualified, Andal qualified, and Emery qualified.
Andal did not qualify.
Oh, sorry.
You almost had it.
And we're back. It's now my turn to evaluate the evaluators. I'd like to start out with Will.
Not yet.
No?
Yeah, rolls. You do the rolls first.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm so eager for my moment in the spotlight. Let me restate that. It's now time for reports from our role players. Could we get a timer's report on each person, please, Mahesh?
For the prepared speeches, losing time was 5 minutes and 15 seconds, and PR time was 7 minutes and 16 seconds. Read time was 5 minutes and 42 seconds. For table topic, Fing Fong time was 1 minute and 54 seconds. Emory time was 1 minute and 43 seconds. And for the speech evaluators, Will Bonds was 2 minutes and 28 seconds. Ryan was 3 minutes and 18 seconds. Amdal was 3 minutes and 45 seconds. And Dan was 3 minutes and 19 seconds.
Thank you for that report. And now, Jean Symington Craig, can you please give us a grammarian report?
Thank you. Day was used twice by Emery, very well, by the way. Raven used it once, also very well. Ryan Pronemiller used it.
I believe so.
You did. And then Andal slipped it in on the side there. She was referring to herself being obfuscated, which is quite good. In terms of creative use of the language, Will had banishing fear and self-loathing. Talking about, which was a little more than Pia had said, but hey, self-loathing. Always love to hear about that. Pia said, I would rather be anywhere else than being here. She also said she was, talked about being most afraid of missing this particular shot, so she was using the basketball analogy quite well, and she was talking about travel being her most important shot. And I loved her ending, her last sentence, I'd rather live my dreams than my fears. Boom. Nailed it. Rick, this is not grammatically exciting, but it was the way he delivered it. I can't do it. I like that. Emery, good evening, Toastmasters and race fans. I like that. He's talking to the audience. And he also said, auto racing is a colossal bore. That was really well done. Dan said, Emery painted a black picture with all of the problems. I like the way he said that. Some others, I was too busy listening. Sometimes I missed hearing something, but all in all, very good. Oh, and I did have one correction, possibly, and this one I may need a little help on. Will said he was talking about Woojin's trip, and he forsaked friends. He got me thinking.
Forsook.
what is the tense? And I thought, forsook? He forsook friends? What would you use there to say past tense, forsake?
His friends have been forsaken.
Forsaken friends.
He did forsake his friends.
Yeah.
He
did, well, but if you
look that up.
Yeah.
I've actually written for, you know, foregoing or
I know, but I know,
but
you've
I
got a good one hanging on there, and
I
that word is and hardly ever use it, so you get kudos for, you know, it was a very high number of difficulty to use. Anyway, so we may have to figure that one out. I thought I forsook, but that sounds weird. So anyway, like to hear that. I know, that red color. There it is again.
Thank you.
That is my report.
Thank you, Jean, for that extremely detailed and lengthy report.
It should be 2 minutes. Do 2 minutes?
You didn't go over.
No.
And now, Bob, could you give us the all-counters report?
Tonight, Huai Jin had several regrets, and one false start, considering his icebreaker is a really nice job. And for Pierre, he had I'm not sure, I cannot tell it's Pierre's deeper breath or I also heard some several so but I think it's a proper interjection word. It's no problem. For Rick, I only get one and. And for Will, I got one stop.
Yeah.
For Tom Click. And Riven had a repeat of I and it. And has three times or repeated I, and about others I didn't catch and yeah, that's the R part.
Okay.
Now for a moment of humor, our greeter and joke master, Dan Craig. A man went on a vacation to a tropical island. He got off the plane and he immediately heard drums. He thought, oh, that's drums, that's nice. So he took the shuttle to the hotel. He was checking in, still the drums are going on. So he asked the manager, did the drums play a lot? The manager just smiled, didn't say anything. He went to dinner, he could hear drums. He went down to the beach, he could hear drums. He went to the bar that night, he could hear drums. He turned to someone and, oh, he saw the manager again. He said, what's with the drums? Did they ever stop? And the manager says, it's very bad if the drums stop. And then he smiled and walked away. It's getting late, the guy's gotta go to bed. He goes to bed, drums, drums, drums. He gets up the next morning, he rushes in, he grabs the manager, he says, what's with the drums? Can you stop them? The manager says, it's very bad if the drums stop, because next is the bass solo. But I do believe it's finally time for me to evaluate evaluators, and I'd like to start with Mr. Will Burns. Will did a nice thing there by having us all give another round of applause to Joaquin, a good way to start an evaluation of an icebreaker, especially. Will gave a good suggestion, simplify the speech, as is appropriate with an icebreaker. He was heavy on his praise, and we all need that all the time, but we especially need it when we're conquering our fears and getting up the first time. for an icebreaker. Example for Will, or example, suggestion for Will. I'm trying to set the example. Move around a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
Also, use those points in the manual. That helps everyone follow along. Raven. I want to go back to Will right quickly. Great phrase, embarked on a hero's journey. I just thought that was eloquent. Okay, Raven's tribute to said it was a treat to see someone overcome our fears before our very eyes. That was very eloquent and a nice thing to say about Pia, and as she was obviously doing something she didn't really want to do, but doing it very well. You did use the manual, which helped us follow along. You were giving very specific and deserved praise to Pia. I thought that you were going to stay back here behind the lectern the whole time, but you were doing that on purpose so you could come out at the end for dramatic effect to demonstrate to Pia how to do it. So, very good use of that. Do you deserve this praise?
Of course.
And Andal, she did, you, not she, you are here. You did use the manual. I can tell you were very listening very closely because you repeated Rick's points. You moved out from the podium. It is difficult to use the manual or use notes and maintain this eye contact. It's so important. And you could work on that a little more. I thought you might do a little better job of speaking to everyone in the room. You were addressing yourself mostly to Rick. But you did give a good suggestion. You wanted more detail from Rick, so that's worth heeding. Ryan, just one quick suggestion. Be as concise as you can so you get more time to speakers.
That's right. I was trying to demonstrate obfuscating.
Oh.
Okay, good job.
Thanks for dinner.
And I was now turn the meeting back over to the Toastmasters. Have a
good thank you.
All right. Before we go to our voting with our president tonight, we get to do the most exciting part of our meeting and give awards for our best of bests. So, first of all, I'm going to announce that who the best evaluator was voted in tonight. Tonight for table topics, drum roll please. Three Sirens! Okay, and for the most exciting award of the evening, our best speaker tonight, drum roll please. Come to the front of the room.
No.
Oh, I did that wrong.
Yeah.
Oh. Good job.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
The speakers next week are Fon, Andal, and Will. Fon, Andal, and Will. And one other thing, when you get the schedule and you see your name is there on a speaker, as a speaker, most of the time I don't have a title, it just says TBA. So if you'll respond to the email to that group, back to me with the title of your speech, and also send it to your evaluator, the title and a brief introduction of yourself. Thank you.
Thank you, Rick.
Okay.
All right. We don't really have a lot of time here, and so I'm apologizing for that, but we do need to get our officers voted tonight. I want to tell you the slate that we have selected with conversations on the side, filling all the officer spots except for, at this point, the sergeant at arms. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you the slate that we have, and then I'm going to ask if there are any nominations from the floor for someone else to be in a particular situation or a particular role. Okay. So the president, this is the slate that we have. President Rick Starr, Vice President of Education Will Burns, Vice President of Membership, Ryan Prana Miller, Vice President of Public Relations, Art Atkinson, Secretary Andal, Treasurer Emery, and then the Sergeant at Arms is the spot that we have open. But that's the one that we use to really pretty much make sure the room is set up and taken down, but we all chip in and do that anyway, so it's a little bit of a lighter role. Also making sure that our inventory is kept up. But the cool thing about being sergeant at arms, I'm just putting it out there, because if it's not, you're not here tonight, you may want to come up and just ask a little bit later, think, you know, that's something we can do. But you get to come to the officer meetings and see what's going on behind the scenes. Okay. So what I'm going to do, just in terms of our time, is are there any nominations from the floor at this point for any of those positions other than what I have indicated? Going once, going twice. Okay. Given that there are, yes, Art?
Hearing none, I move that the nominations be closed.
Okay, thank you. Do I have a second on that?
I'll second his motion.
Okay. All right. So the nominations are closed. At this point, since we don't have contenders for any of the positions, I'm going to ask someone make a motion that we vote on the slate as a total entity rather than line by line.
Make a motion, we vote on the slate as a whole.
Second.
Okay. And I want to make sure you guys, this side of the room gets to, you know, participate. Okay, so we have, are you guys following
really
this?
No, the procedure, the Democratic.
Yeah, this is parliamentary procedure, somewhat adopted for the situation. Okay, so I'm going to read the slate one more time, and then we have had a motion, we've had it seconded, that we go ahead and take this slate as is. Is there any discussion on this particular slate right now? Otherwise, we'll vote.
I don't like any of them. I'm just kidding. I'm obfuscating.
What time? What's the first meeting?
Okay, we'll get there. This is a little bit out of order. We have a motion on the floor. Okay, I'm going to close the discussion. The motion is that we have for our upcoming officers for the 2016-2017 year, Rick is president, Will's vice president of education, Ryan Pontemiller, vice president of membership, Art is VP of PR, vice president of public relations, Andal as secretary, and Emery as treasurer. Okay. All in favor, and only members, please. Please say aye.
Aye.
And I should really be able to hear the nays if there's a nay here. So any opposed? The motion has passed. Before we clap them in, let's have current officers please stand. And that would be Rick Starr's Vice President of Education. Who's our Vice President of Membership is Emery. Vice President of PR and Secretary has been Will Burns. The Treasurer has been Dan Craig. I've been your President. Let's go ahead and clap them for all.
Comment, although it's not an official officer's position, I'd like to recognize Dan for being the club videographer and all the work he puts in every week in getting the videotape edited and posted on various sources. So,
yes.
Thank
you. It almost deserves its own position. Okay, so what we'll be doing is now let's go ahead and have the new officers stand. All of you guys that I said your name. Okay, and let's. Service is a very big part of Toastmasters. It helps you support and grow the club members, and it also develops leadership in you. We'll be expecting you next Tuesday, 6:45. We've been meeting over in the restaurant area, grabbing a table. If you'd like to catch the all-day, all-you-can-eat salad bar, just get that done ahead of time if possible so we can be starting at 6:45. Rick has already announced the first training, July 9th, so we'll be organizing that in our meeting. And I want to make sure everybody has a book because between now and next Tuesday, we want to make sure you read your section, what your role is in here, and you'll also see that all the other roles are described and mentioned, so you can start to get an overview of what the team looks like, who's doing what and where. I'm delighted that we have this officer group. It's going to be really strong. Toastmasters, this is a great thing, and we look forward to having others serve on these in the future. And I'm just gonna stop talking here because I'm just too filled with bliss and excitement that we've gotten this done. Okay, so thank you. And you guys sit down.
The officers meeting, inauguration.
What?
We get like an inauguration party.
Ah, yes, well, so hold this date. Hold the last Tuesday in June. And that is?
28th.
We will have a year-end celebration. We will also inaugurate and bring in our new officers and install them in their positions. During the month of June, old officers and new officers will be coordinating and downloading to each other what they're supposed to be doing, so we have a mentoring going on there. Okay, so this is really, really good. Congratulations, Maya, for joining, even though you had nothing else to do. You know, it was this or learn knitting, right? So, but I think you're going to enjoy it.
Yeah.
And everyone else, we'll see you next week. Meeting is adjourned.